Hello and welcome. My name is Sanjay Soni. Here's a micro-learning readiness video on Azure SQL Data Warehouse interactive query demos. Thank you for taking the time to join us. Now, let's get started. Hi, Charles. How are you doing today?
Good, thank you. Good to be here.
Awesome. So what do you do at Microsoft?
So I'm a principal program manager in the SQL Data Warehouse team. So I focus particularly on that cloud service, making sure our customers are happy, services working well, and just, you know, day-to-day making sure everything's ticking.
So let's get started. So I know there's a concept of replicated tables, distributed tables in Azure SQL Data Warehouse. Can you please show us how all this works?
Sure. So I think the best way to do that is probably just to dive into the code and take a look at some queries. And we'll do that in SQL Management Studio. So we'll start on the left-hand side with the Object Explorer. And what you can see here is some very subtle differences in icons that sort of gives you some insight as to the type of tables. You know, in SQL Server, we sort of had a table, you create a table. There were variants of it optimized for analytics or for transactional workloads. Mm-hmm. In SQL Data Warehouse, we offer some different table types based on query performance, optimizing workloads. But as I said, they're often sort of second stage optimizations. You know, the ability to run just out of the box performance is something that we very much believe in. And so the defaults that can exist just by creating a table, actually without any knowledge at all that distributed tables even exist, mm-hmm. still deliver a very, very high level of performance. Mm-hmm. So if we take a look here, I've got a few queries and we'll just work through them. But on the left-hand side, you can see three very subtle icons. So this top one here for dim customer, you can see there's a little gap. That means that the table's distributed, but it's hash distributed. And so we separate columns across different buckets based on a given value. And this can be a very powerful optimization. The second one down here has this little yellow stripe. This means that it's a round robin distribution. What this means is that we just spread records out across the various buckets. And it's very useful for tables where you're doing a lot of aggregation, not necessarily a whole lot of joins, but this is really the default that customers start with. And it guarantees a very good balance of data so that in a distributed environment where you've got multiple machines, everyone's doing about the same amount of work, which means you're really optimizing for your performance.
So basically you're keeping all compute nodes busy on all machines.
That's right. That's okay. Right. One of the biggest problems you can have in distributed computing or distributed databases is you get what's called skew, where you've got more records being served by one machine than another. And so the other sort of machines will finish sooner, but one is still running. And so you're only as fast as your slowest node, exactly. And so skew can sometimes impact you. So round robin is a very balanced spread across the machines. Mm-hmm. And then finally, the third is replica table. And this nation replicated down here is a good example. You can see that the tables sort of have two panes on top of each other. What this means is that when you create this table, we'll actually create a replica of it for the various scale factor that you're working at. And this is very powerful for joins. Commonly, we use these for dimension tables, smaller tables. Yeah. And where I do a sort of a classical star join, say, sales join to customer, geography, product maybe. Yeah. The customer geography, they're typically the replica tables.
Got it. Smaller dimension tables.
Yeah. So we can drill into this, and I'll show you sort of some lower level nuances. So this is a 10 terabyte scale workload as well. Not all tables are exactly the same, but it'll be pretty snappy performance. So what you can see here, actually, if I look at the plan for this, the graphical plan in SSMS, is I can see this is a replica table. So again, I can be developing. I don't need to look at icons. There's all sorts of ways to determine what you're operating on, and this is just one of those examples. Now, if I go and do exactly the same query against supplier, which I happen to know was distributed before I got here, I can again run this execution plan. Results come back very quickly. And if I take a look at this, you'll see, okay, now this is a distributed table and this is of hash distribution. So a lot of tooling, very powerful tooling for developers to really quickly see, I could be a new developer coming onto a platform. I don't know how this was built. I don't know exactly what I've got to work with. Very quickly, I can see exactly what I'm working with and I understand how to optimize for these objects. So let's go down a little bit. The next example is, let's go do something a little bigger. Let's go and do a join between a replicated and distributed table. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to show you the plan for this. And what you can see here is that I'm getting records from a replica table. I'm getting records from a distributed table. There's no data movement here, right? They're able to join. And that's because when a replica table exists, in my distributed cluster that I'm working on, one table exists entirely on every single machine. Yes. So I can make a localized join on each machine. Very performant, very scalable, parallelizes very, very well. And then this shuffle move that you see further on means that we've just reshuffled an aggregate of the records because we're grouping by nation. And so we need to relocalize records to then group them again. But this is a very, very performant query. This is a classical distributed data warehousing query.
It's a typical example.
Exactly. So let's take a look a little further. Here we get a little more complex again. Now I'm saying, actually, I want to do a join between a hash distributed table and another hash distributed table. So this is interesting, right? When you distribute tables on a hashing key, there's smarts built into the platform to say that the value of one table will be on the same bucket or the same location as that same value in another table. And so in this instance, I'm joining line item on orders. I'm distributing my orders table on O order key, and I'm distributing my line item on L order key. Mm-hmm. So the smarts built into the platform, that distributed optimizer knows, hey, I know that I've got all the records I need for each table in one place. I don't need to move data. And so again, scales really well, parallelizes really well. And you know, you see sort of a near, I would say, linear performance that as you scale out the elastic compute mm-hmm. And less data belongs to each machine, you'll see that performance sort of declines or improves, I should say, as you add more compute. And this is really the perfect scenario that you're going for, the fact that adding more capacity reduces your execution time.
Scalable.
Absolutely. So now let's look at something a little interesting here. I'm looking at the table orders, but I'm looking at two different columns. I'm looking at the order key, which we just talked about. That's my distribution key. And then I'm also doing a count of distinct values on the customer key. Now, what's interesting about hash distribution is that a given value, pick a number, Sanjay.
Okay, 40.
40, all right. So imagine I've got a row with customer ID 40, right? Or imagine I've got 1,000 rows with customer ID 40. When we arrange those in a distributed table, every row that has customer ID 40 will be in one place.
Yeah. Right?
And we know that. It's something we trust in and the optimizer trusts in for making decisions on how to best execute a query. So what happens here is when I say, give me the count distinct of order key, imagine I'm looking for 40, and I'm hashed on that key, it knows all I need to do is count the distinct records on each bucket, mm-hmm. sum them up, and that's the answer. And so when I go run this query, you'll see that it's going to come back relatively quickly. So we'll give this a few seconds to execute. Now what I'm going to do immediately after this is go run a count distinct on the customer key. And we'll look at this plan here. The query's finished. And so this was really simple. I looked at them, I was able to group them. I actually rolled them up to my control node, my central node, where I do sort of final aggregations often. Really simple query, perfect distinct count. And again, you will scale very well with this, with the elastic compute.
I see.
Now, if I go and do the same thing, same table, same query, I'm just replacing a column, what you'll see here is this will take a little longer, and we'll look at the plan, and you're going to see a shuffle movement. And that's because I'm distributed on order key, which means I don't really know where all of my customers are. You know, the same order will exist orders of similar will exist here, but customers have many orders and they could be spread in a distributed manner. Mm-hmm. So if we take a look at that plan, what you're going to see, as I just scroll out to the right here, is you'll see we've got a shuffle here. And so what's actually happened is we've looked for the distinct values in each bucket, each distribution, I should say, is really how we think about these. And we found them, but then we've reshuffled on that key and looked again, right? So it's a two-stage. Again, you can see it's performant. The optimizer, the platform figures it all out. It's not like, oh, if I want to run a distinct count, I need to be distributed on a key. But having the control over table geometries, being able to say, no, I really want to distribute on this key for this workload. I really want to replicate. I want table partitioning because I know that if I can prune partitions and then look for, you know, order keys within maybe one partition, that's going to be really performant instead of maybe looking over the whole set if my dates aren't particularly well ordered.
There's a flexibility in the system.
There's a lot of flexibility. I'd say it's almost like it understands what you want. You know, it's sort of, I'd say it's malleable almost. That Great. You just tell it, it will figure it out for you. Forgiving, perhaps, is the word that I was looking for, in case you write a bad query, Sanjay, which I'm sure you've never done.
No, I've done that before. I was parallel data warehouse TSP before. So.
I know. Okay, so let's look at another function that we introduced in recently. You know, so you get a lot of scenarios where you want exact results. Like if I'm reporting financial data or if I'm reporting your manufacturing output, right? Having an exact number, because I might be looking at my performance month on month, is really important, right? And especially where you're working with very small variances, you know, where even a slight change is important, having exact values is critical. But imagine I'm doing something like web analytics, and I'm looking at clicks, or I'm looking at views, right? Huge numbers of records where, you know, 1,000 or 2,000 here or there is, I'm willing to make a trade-off for performance. So if I take a look again and I go run my count distinctive orders, what you'll see here is this will take a few seconds, and it's synthetic data. We're going to get a lot of zeros, as you saw, but this is the exact number, right? And so this will run, and it took about 8 seconds. Okay, so I can have the exact number, and the price I pay is 8 seconds. Mm-hmm. But what if I don't need that? What if I'm doing, you know, trend analysis where I might be plotting a line graph, for example, over a relatively large time axis, and in fact, you know, we're talking about such large scales that the resolution of my monitor can't even move the line, you know, to the exact result. What I'd love is to be able to go faster, right? Because I want to turn these trends quickly. So we have a function called the approximate count distinct. And what this does is it gives you an approximation of the distinct values. It's not exact, but as you'll see here, it goes a lot faster.
Yeah.
And so this will come back in 1 second. And so if you take a look, and I just scroll down to my next guy here, I've got them both side by side, just to make the comparison. Mm-hmm. Same table, same column. The only thing different is the function. And what you get here is an exact value and approximate, which is very, very close. It's within a sort of degree of accuracy. And for certain scenarios, this would be a very, very suitable solution, where I can turn, as I said, performance. And it comes back to that performance theme. You know, we really believe that having a highly performant platform is incredibly valuable to our customers.
Wow, that was fantastic. Any other final thoughts before we wrap up this session?
Not really. We think, the service has been very popular. We're seeing a lot of customers be incredibly successful, doing things they've never really been able to do. You know, SQL is the language for analysts, for tools, you know, whether it's Power BI, Tableau, others that just want to layer reports, analytics, and get more insights out of their data. So, you know, SQL Data Warehouse, you've got the performant platform, the scalability, but a really easy platform to approach and run your interactive queries on. Let the platform do the work for you. It'll handle the complexity and give those results back as fast as it possibly can.
Wow, it's great to see your passion for the product.
Absolutely.
And thanks for being here with us today.
You bet, anytime.
Thank you for watching this video. Learn more about this and other topics at azure.com/SQLDW.